Hi, and welcome to sunny San Jose. We're at Advancing AI 2025. And I have the honor and the pleasure to have AMD's EVP and CTO, Mark Papermaster, here today. Hey, Mark.
Hi, Bryan. Thanks for
having
me.
Great to have you here. Yes, and this is the second year that we've done this.
Yes.
So really excited to follow up from our conversation from last year as well. Let's get straight into it, Mark. Today we had many announcements. What's your thoughts about the announcements today and how we showed up as a company to developers and to customers and to partners?
Well, what I think the key takeaway from today was the progress we've made. You refer back to the last time we chatted on, you know, so let's say go back to the last episode. And where were we at that time? We had a few key partners of hyperscalers that had taken our Instinct products, had applied ROCm, and were actually running production inference. So it was a huge milestone. And a lot of questions people had is, will AMD be able to actually keep up with the roadmap? Will they be able to be, in fact, on an annual cadence to keep performance moving up and to the right, which is and at the torrid pace that our customers demand? And where will the ROCm software stack go? And will AMD, in fact, be able to make good on their commitment to create an open ecosystem and an open software stack? Will there be traction? And so what I love about today is emphatic statements on all three. We showed our roadmap that we in fact pulled our next generation MI350 series in several months.
Amazing.
And we're in production start of Q3. Fantastic inferencing products where you can get up to a 35x throughput improvement, but it also is designed to support right through mid-scale training in addition to that inference. And as well, starting to pull the veil back a little bit about the MI400 series the following year and how that is being readied for mass scale for both training and inference. So I think, you know, one was showing what has been a hallmark at AMD, and that's our execution excellence, really doing what we said and executing it at quality. Secondly, from a software standpoint, really hearing from customers. Hearing from customers, yes, those hyperscalers, we heard from Meta and the progress that they have made and much expanded deployment, but we heard from many others who are running on the ROCm software stack and could attest to the progress that we've made. And then thirdly, the resounding statement and commitment of AMD to open standards. We made announcements of where we actually have specs out to support interoperability with others in the industry, and in fact, where we are in AMD and our roadmap to support them. So those are the several, you know, key takeaways from today.
That's amazing, Mark, and thanks for that summary. You know, let's just double click on open standards for a second, because I think the word open was the thread all the way through today. How important are open standards to the future of the industry?
Well, I think you have to think about the history of computing. It doesn't do well when there's just one player. And we've had this several times in history. There was, I grew up at IBM, so I well know what a complete vertical walled garden solution looks like. And if you can look at the history of IBM, it kept that mainframe solution. There's still mainframes today, but the industry demanded open solutions and IBM went that way. Open source at the end always wins out. So did you see it the same in phones? There's now open source, alternatives with Android, many different Android models out there. This is the moment for the AI ecosystem to stand up and create an open alternative, and we're doing that with open standards. So on connectivity at the network level, Ultra Ethernet promises excellent performance, as well as features that have been only available in InfiniBand. There's really only one company offering InfiniBand today, but with Ultra Ethernet, it's going to be a broad consortium. It's going to have all the congestion management and the features that people need to really build out AI networks. Secondly, ultra acceleration link, and that's not the scale out like UEC, Ultra Ethernet, it's the scale up. How do you build big AI nodes? And we're seeing a strong adoption of UALink. And what we showed today was the commitment we have and how we are deploying a UALink in our roadmap. And we have partners coming on stage with us to be a part of that. So That, along with our open source ROCm stack, is a very clear message of choice that we're giving to the industry.
Well, that's a really good segue into my next question, which is actually on ROCm 7, because the one moment that I took from today was our solution approach, and you mentioned it about our open standards and open source and ROCm 7. You know, why should developers care about ROCm 7? Why is it important?
Well, when you think about ROCm 7, I mean, it's first of all, you know, ROCm 6.0 and all the subsequent releases were all about showing the capabilities of AMD at production level. Mm-hmm. What we're doing with ROCm 7, it's a clear statement of our focus on developers. So what have we done? It supports expanded performance for Triton. Triton's a vendor agnostic language to allow you to compile and optimize onto AMD, but also other accelerator platforms. It's a statement around creating a support for distributed inference to be able to get much more efficacy, particularly needed in these modes of inferencing where you have reasoning, where you're having prefill and decode, the two key stages of running that inference, having very, very different demands on the GPU. And with this distributed inferencing approach, we're able to optimize in how the scheduling is done. Beyond that, the expanded support for how our customers get the updates. If you think back to 2024, those updates were less frequent because the focus was really on those hyperscaler customers who are really pounding and testing out and making ROCm the solid software stack it is today. But that's completely changed with ROCm 7. So now we have nightly continuous integration, continuous development of the open source LLMs. We have every 2 weeks a release of the dockers and the containers of the updates that are needed and the community which are being promoted going out. So it's a tremendous difference in to be able to support developers and computer and users of the ROCm stack to make sure they have the latest and greatest. And then lastly, what I just love about today was the announcement on the developer cloud, just making it so easy to jump on our platform, single click download of the whole ROCm software and access to a developer cloud to speed your development of applications for AMD Instinct.
And I think you're absolutely right. That I got very excited about that moment, and I think the audience got excited as well, because it gives opens more accessibility towards GPUs in the cloud and helps speed up the pace of innovation. And I think last year we spoke about that as being one of the things you were predicting for the future, that there would be more focus on developers. And I think we've done a really good job to kind of get to bridge to that. But what do you think is next? What do you think is next for AMD and AI and where we are as a company, but also where our ecosystem is?
Well, what I look for in the AI ecosystem is what we've had in the CPU server ecosystem that we've been very successful part of, is we brought competition to the CPU ecosystem. You first introduce the concept that there's going to be competition. Then you create proof points and you start building applications. That's what we did in the second generation of our CPU server. In the third generation, which would mimic what we're doing now with MI 350 series, you start really building up the mass of ISVs, the software applications, which are certified and running on your application. So that's the next phase from us. That's why these developer enhancements are so key, because you have to lower barriers, grease the glide path to bring the developers on. So what's next is really a very, very quick acceleration of applications, which then brings a much larger user community. And that's when you're gonna see our open source capabilities really kick in and differentiate us. That's gonna be critical for us to expand our market and the applications that we support with that much broader user community.
Well, Mark, on that note, I'd just like to say thanks for taking time to talk to us and our audience and sharing your thoughts. And I'm looking forward to our next conversation and the more advancements that we will make in the future as well. So thank you, Mark.
Excellent. Thank you, Bryan.
Thank you.
Enjoyed the chat.